Today I'm going to speak on Binayak Sen, and Binayak Sen's case is something that every Indian must understand and get involved with, because it concerns every Indian's right to ideology, right to protest against government oppression, right to work for the society, right to free thinking, and right to justice. So who is Binayak Sen? Binayak Sen is a doctor. He's a MBBS, MD, and he has been working for the last 30 years for the poorest of poor of India in the districts of Chhattisgarh. And when you work for the poorest of poor in India, then obviously you work for a lot of people who are not properly educated, and therefore they are very often antisocial, they do various wrong things, and your job is to sympathize with them and educate them towards better understanding about life and society. And that's exactly what Binayak Sen had been doing for 30 long years, and his work has been awarded by the entire world. The best and most prestigious of awards have been bestowed upon him for his excellent commitment to the society and patriotism. So what has Binayak Sen been charged with? He has been charged with meeting a Naxalite leader called Narayan Sanyal in jail about 33 times under absolute close supervision of the police with police permission. And he has been charged for exchanging letters with Narayan Sen on his ill health. Of course, he has also been charged for some hilarious crimes. His crime includes reading books by Mao and his thoughts, Mao Zedong, who is the father of modern day China. And he has been charged for reading Karl Marx's Das Kapital. I mean, by that standard, I think that I am a criminal as well. I think the entire Jawaharlal Nehru University is full of criminals. I think 50% of Bengal is full of criminals. I think half of the world is full of criminals. Because if you are educated and if you want to know about world, then you must have read at one point of time or the other Karl Marx's Das Kapital. Who is Karl Marx? And how dare somebody charge anybody for reading Karl Marx? Do people even know who is Karl Marx? In the turn of the millennium, BBC did an online voting, and around the world people voted on various categories. One of those categories was the world's greatest philosopher. And Karl Marx was voted by the entire world as the world's greatest philosopher of the last millennium. That's Karl Marx. It's his ideology which at one point of time was running more than two-thirds of the world, and even today, half of the world from Latin America to China to Russia are run because of his ideology. A man who said that the world is divided into two, the haves and the have-nots. There is no philosophy which is stronger, more truthful and more committed to humanity than Karl Marx's philosophy, which he has outlined in Das Kapital. And for reading that philosophy, if you are considered a criminal, then it's a shame on the people who pronounce such judgments, it's a shame on the state who tries to convict such a man, and it's a shame on the entire Indian democracy. And that is why Binayak Sen is a very important cause for every Indian to take up. Binayak Sen is a man who has non-stop been working for the oppressed. In fact, the entire concept of Naxalites being called terrorists has to be questioned. Because who are Naxalites? We need to answer this question first. To me, Naxalites are products of state-sponsored terrorism. When the state turns a terrorist for the common man, and how does a state turn a terrorist to a common man? A state turns a terrorist for the common man when the state doesn't fulfill its duties. And duties which help the common man survive. Duties like giving him access to food. If the state doesn't give you access to food, if the state doesn't give you access to health, and state keeps you in sub-Saharan standards of destitution, if the state doesn't give you education, if the state doesn't give you employment, then not protesting against that is crime. And one of those forms of protest, and maybe wrong, maybe very extreme, is Naxalism, but they are a product of states terrorism against the common man. When the state doesn't give you food, when the state doesn't give you life, when the state doesn't give you justice, then you protest. And one of those protests, and during those protests, people pick up arms as well. It's very debatable who was more correct, Mahatma Gandhi or Subhash Chandra Bose. Because one believed in picking up arms and the other believed in non-violence. Worldwide, violent revolutions have brought about changes. And Naxalites believe in violent revolution. It could be philosophically wrong. And the state has all the right to arrest them, comb them out, and try to change their mindset. But the fact is that give these very people health, give these very people food, give these very people education, then give them justice, give them employment, and there would be no Naxalite movement. Because their only agenda is that the state must not keep them marginalized. And the unfortunate reality in India today is that Naxalites enjoy a huge support base amongst the poorest of poor where they rule. And they almost rule 50% of India's poorest of poor belts. And they have become one of India's biggest internal security threats. And where have they come from? And why do they exist at the first place? They exist at the first place because the government, the politicians don't have a heart. Their heart beats for corruption, their heart beats where money lies, their heart beats for greed, and their heart doesn't beat for poor. Their heart doesn't beat for the poorest of the poor. Their heart doesn't beat for the hungriest. Their heart doesn't beat to give people access to health and education. And where their heart doesn't beat for that, they leave people marginalized in the society. And when you leave people marginalized in the society, there are various kinds of protests which are going to take place. And some of them are going to be damn violent. And you better be prepared for it, because you kept them oppressed, because you terrorized them into picking up arms. You terrorize their lives. They were terrorized that they are not going to live anymore. And the only way they thought that they can live is by picking up arms and trying to protest against state atrocities. And these are the people who need compassion. They need to be given access to health. They need to be given access to food. And they need to be dealt with love. And they need to be made to be felt. They need to be brought inside the rooms. They need to be dealt with compassion, and they need to be given access to everything that a state must give access to every human being who has voted you to power. And this is exactly what Binayak Sen was doing for the last 30 years of his life, showing compassion to the poorest of poor, giving them access to health, giving them access to food. And he must have seen to it that many people do not turn into Naxalites just because he was doing a social service. He was doing an act of compassion which the government should have been doing at the first place. He was helping the government by doing a job that the government should have been doing. And when you need to control something like Naxalism, then of course the state police mechanism has to be more effective. But very important is trying to engage with them. And for that, a person like Binayak Sen would have been hugely effective, because he has been working with the tribals, he has access to the tribals, they listen to him, they look up to him as a messiah. And it is instead of using somebody like Binayak Sen to have a dialogue with the Naxalites as a mediator who can give the promises that, hey, hold on, drop your arms, because I am with the state and you believe me, and I am giving you a guarantee that this state is going to give you access to food. This state is going to give you access to health. This state is going to give you access to education. This state is going to give you access to justice. And I am there to tell you that. And instead of doing that and promising people what they rightfully must get, instead of doing all that, what do we do? We pick up Binayak Sen and give him life imprisonment. That is terrorism against humanity. It is extremely, extremely, extremely sad and extremely shameful that somebody like Binayak Sen, who's a patriotic man, who's a social worker, who has been doing something that the state should have been doing at the first place, is today behind the jails thanks to our state. And it's 360-degree terrorism. First, it doesn't give you food. then it doesn't give you health, then it doesn't give you education, then it doesn't give you justice, it doesn't give you employment. You protest, you're put behind the bar. The 360 degree state dictatorship and terrorism comes a full circle and tries to control your life so that you never raise the voice against oppression. And this is extremely, extremely sad. And it calls for every Indian to come out united and to say that we need Binayak Sen and more people like Binayak Sen in this country, working for the poorest of poor, selflessly, in a country where doctors would rather earn their millions in the cities and towns. Here is a man who's extremely educated, who's a doctor, but who sacrifices all pleasures, all possible luxuries of life, and goes to the villages, the poorest of poor villages, and works for the oppressed out there. And we jail him because he has read Mao and he has been reading Karl Marx and he has been treating people regardless of their ideology just because they are poorest of poor, and amongst them some might have been naturalized. And this is the unfortunate case of Binayak Sen. We should be having our corrupt criminal politicians inside the jail. Binayak Sen will be outside the jail serving the society and humanity, for which we must all come together and join a protest.